Welcome to The Journey Home. My name is Marcus Grodi, your host for this weekly program. Our guest this week is Dr. Paul Thigpen. Paul was an ordained Protestant pastor, as well as a professional writer and editor for 12 years before he and his entire family were received into the Catholic Church in 1993. He is now an assistant professor of religious studies at Southwest Missouri State University and continues to write books and articles, including several studies on preparing for the Jubilee year 2000. Because of these books, we had originally intended to focus our program on the theme of the Jubilee. But after reviewing Paul's conversion story this afternoon, it became very evident that a most compelling topic for us to discuss, which fits in both with his own spiritual journey home, as well as the events and issues of these last days of this millennium, is the reality of the devil and the demonic. Now, let me remind you that you are a very important part of this program, so please either call in your questions to 1-800-221-9460 or email us at journeyhome@ewtn.com. Well, Paul, welcome to The Journey Home.
Thank you, Marcus. It's good to be here.
You know, I've said this a mess of times, but one of the great privileges of this program is it allows me the opportunity to get together with old buddies that I don't see very often. And, you know, our topic tonight, I just mentioned that we originally planned to talk on the Jubilee because, as I might mention to the audience, you have a book on preparing for the Jubilee called Celebrate 2000, which is Reflections on Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and the Father from Pope John Paul II.
That's right.
And a wonderful book on that. But as we were sharing on that this afternoon, I realized from your own journey that even in preparation for the end of this millennia and preparation for the great year of 2000, that it is important for us to get out on the table the reality of the devil, the demonic, and the spiritual battle that we're all in. And we live in a day when there's great confusion on this issue. It's a very important part of the journey, isn't it?
You're right, Marcus. The confusion abounds. You have everything from people who act like Flip Wilson's old character who said, "The devil made me do whatever it is that they did wrong." You have people with an unhealthy preoccupation with the devil, and you have people, sometimes even so-called Catholic theologians, publicly denying the existence of the devil.
Yeah, no wonder
there's confusion.
Yeah, I remember hearing Paul Harvey tell the rest of the story one day, but what he was telling the story about was what he would do if he were the devil. And the first thing he said is, "Well, I'd convince everybody that I don't exist."
That's right.
And that's the way the devil can work in our lives and can influence us, our decisions, our families, our relationships. And so especially as we prepare during these last years of this millennium and look forward to that great time of joy that John Paul speaks about, we have to be aware of the battle we're in. But before we jump into that topic, let's ask you, if you would, to share a bit with us about your own spiritual journey home.
Marcus, I was born into a Christian family, raised in the Presbyterian Church, I believe you were, and but had some spiritual poison, you might say, fed to me about the age of 12. I had a teacher put some of the works of Voltaire, the skeptic philosopher, in my hands and began to read it, and that combined with my own beginning adolescent rebellion, my rebellion against my parents, I think, took that turn, that I thought I'd rebel against their faith. And so at the age of 12, I became an arrogant little atheist.
Wow.
And was for 6 years.
That's amazing. That almost speaks to the topic of the responsibility of us parents to being careful on what we put into the hands of our children.
Yes,
especially
now,
at that very touching age that you talked about.
Now, of course, my parents had nothing to do with
right.
it, but it was a teacher that I had. And over those years, began to try to work out the implications of that. I became, I guess you'd say, a classic secular humanist. Hmm. And during that time, I became convinced that if given enough time and enough of the right education and training, that humanity was perfectible and that we could build a utopia on Earth. In some ways, I was kind of a perfect little enlightenment person about several centuries too late. Mm-hmm. And it went that way, but the funny thing was that I still had a spiritual hunger, even though I had come to the place of denying that there was anything mm-hmm. beyond the universe of matter and energy. I still had a hunger for the supernatural. And the way I finally found to feed that was by taking what I thought was the scientific approach to the study of parapsychology. Mm. In the 12th grade, not long after I had lost my faith, I did a science project on parapsychology. I wrote off to Duke University, got their test materials from the Institute for Parapsychological Research, did tests of myself and others to try to see if I could discover any extrasensory powers. And from that, it was a short step into other things that I thought I would examine scientifically. I thought they were probably just powers of the human mind that had been undiscovered. And through that, began to get involved in things like seances, Ouija boards, and all the rest. So it wasn't long before I was deeply into that, all the while thinking that any time something that seemed to be supernatural happened, it was really just some power of my own mind that I was uncovering. But that all came to a sudden halt in my senior year of high school. And I won't go into details, but I had an encounter early on in that year with what I knew to be, number one, a personality that was not part of my own mental power. It was not an extension of myself. It was something different from myself. And it wasn't Casper the Friendly Ghost. It was something out to eat my lunch.
Wow.
It terrified me. I didn't know what to do with it. I went to a Christian teacher who was a dear friend of mine. She said to me, "You've had a brush with the devil." And I said, "Oh, don't be so medieval. This is the 20th century." But I got to thinking about it, and it drove me back to the scripture. She put almost like an antidote to the other stuff I had read. Here was another teacher who put something much better in my hands. She gave me C.S. Lewis to read.
Yes.
I read the introduction to the Screwtape Letters, talking about the devil and Christian theology, and a number of other things. And over a period of time, through answered prayer, experiments in prayer, reading the scripture, the grace of God through a number of people who surrounded me with their love, in a few months' time, I became a Christian.
You know, I'm thinking about that kind of conversion must have driven you to your knees in relationship to what you had been in.
Oh, it was awful. I mean, I realized, I guess in a sense, and I came to believe in the devil before I believed in God. And I realized if there was a devil and there was no God, I was really in trouble. I'd better find out if there was a devil. And I was so grateful to find out that there was, and that it was not some eternal battle between good and evil whose outcome was uncertain, but that God was God, that he was going to win, that the devil had limited power, that the devil was not going to win, and I was on God's side.
How did this conversion then shape your life from that point?
Well, it totally turned everything upside down. This was at the end of my senior year of high school. I had been accepted at Yale and had had all kinds of plans to go into pre-law and go into law school, that kind of thing, go into politics. All my ambitions were changed then.
In which direction? I mean, I'm sure in the spiritual direction, but did you immediately see a vocation to ministry or
what? Well, what I did was after one semester at college, I thought, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I've got to sort everything out. So I took off, went to work on the mission field in Europe with a Christian group there, Teen Challenge. Mm-hmm. Worked with them for 2 years, feasted on people like C.S. Lewis, G.K. Chesterton, and others, grew up spiritually. Then I came back to Yale and majored in religious studies.
Okay. Then from there, how did you get into a kind of a groove spiritually? Did you have a goal for your life? Did you get involved with ministry continuing?
Well, pretty soon it became clear that I enjoyed writing, seemed to have a gift for it. And it was pretty soon after that, I got married, and then after that, pretty soon I began a writing career.
Okay. So you were as a writer. Let's go back then and ask you at this time as a writer with many feet in the fire of ministry, it seems, at least all two of them. How did you then view the demonic, the devil, from this Protestant perspective?
Well, of course, it was shaped by my own experience. But in addition to that, I was a part of a Pentecostal community. And of course, the Pentecostal community is quite sensitive to the reality of the demonic in the world. Mm. And so both in Europe, there were a number of things I saw there that confirmed what I'd seen before. Yeah. But I moved in circles that were quite open to that reality, that affirmed it, that attempted through prayer to combat it, to deal with it. And so again and again, it only confirmed my experience. It's not that I had my attention on it all the time,
right?
But I knew that that the reality was certainly there.
We recognize that, and you recognize in that thing, that a total acceptance of God, being accepting his word and accepting his creation of the visible and invisible world and the reality of the devil and his hordes. I mean, that isn't just one myth and the rest is reality.
That's right.
You know, and that's what the danger is, that you start writing one off as myth, and pretty soon you write the rest off as myth.
No, that it's that difficult to believe. Once you believe that God became flesh, my goodness, what else could be, you know, less amazing than that?
Well, we'll be back in just a moment. It's Please stay with us, and we'll continue to explore this very important topic. Welcome back. We've been talking with Dr. Paul Thigpen about the issue of the reality of the devil and demonic. Paul, let's jump right into what is it that opened your heart to the reality of the Catholic Church?
Well, it's interesting that one of the smaller things, I won't say it was a major thing, was that I came, when I began to explore this notion of the demonic teachings of the Christian tradition, I found that one of the churches other than the Pentecostal tradition I was in that actually took this seriously was the Catholic Church. Mm. In fact, a number of Pentecostal Christians who came up against this reality and were trying to find out what to do about it found themselves going back to Catholic sources to read about accounts, to find out how the church approached exorcism, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And I found that to be one of many situations in which realities I'd already discovered as a Pentecostal Christian were finding a fullness of realization in the Catholic Church. But in particular, I think what helped me in this direction was that I began a PhD program in historical theology. Mm-hmm. And as I began to study church history, one by one, all of my misconceptions about the church changed, and many of the fears I'd had I found were unfounded. But also I began to see that the church was an organism mm-hmm. that grows across the centuries, that in my own tradition we had tried to go back to some kind of primitive church and to try to find the church in its purity, when actually the church in the beginning was more of an embryo. Yeah. It was something that developed over the centuries. John Newman helped me to understand that.
Yes.
And I finally came to the place where I realized I had been a part of on a branch and I wanted to be in the trunk.
Mm-hmm. And it's such a rewarding experience, I have found, to all of a sudden have your whole horizon opened by reading primary sources of the saints, St. Augustine and others, and seeing that you don't have to be afraid of those old writings. I almost felt a bit as a Protestant that, you know, I was a little bit nervous about digging deep into what I might find, but the reality is you find there the continuous witness of the church. And just to remind the audience that your entire story is the first chapter of the Surprised by Truth book. Encourage the audience to look for this book printed by Basilica Press, which would give all the details of your story and that of your family. But let's jump now into this topic for tonight, because I think it's very important. We never have enough time to cover all aspects of this, but maybe a way of getting into it and asking the question of what, in fact, does the Catholic Church teach about the person of the devil and his horde, as the St. Michael prayer does it. I thought I would use the catechism, but maybe to give you some questions to answer, sure. Use the index underneath the title Devil : Satan in the index of the catechism. It's a good little outline. So let me put for you question one. It describes the devil as a fallen angel in his rebellion against God. Who is the devil?
I'm glad we're starting there, and I'd urge people to take the catechism themselves. Yes. And take a look at it. But the first thing I think we have to understand is that the church teaches that we are not the only intelligent race that God created, that there is another race of intelligences, that they are non-corporeal, which means they do not have physical bodies as we do, that they are pure spirit, and that this race also has a free will as well as intelligence the same way we do, and that at some point, some members of that race made the choice against God to prefer themselves to God, their own will to God. And in their case, it was an irrevocable choice.
And this is extremely scriptural, right?
Oh, yes. It's all through. I mean, I don't see how you could be a biblical Christian without accepting this. It was essential in the ministry of Jesus. Exorcism was one of the three primary things that he did, along with preaching and healing. Mm. And it's also, of course, all through the Old Testament as well, in the New Testament.
It's hard to imagine that these beings, the invisible supernatural world, could turn their backs on God.
That is unimaginable to us, although we ourselves have done it. But I suppose it seems hard to believe that someone who could see the face of God as they do would nevertheless make that choice. And in some sense, I think a number of writers in the church have suggested that's why the choice was irrevocable. Mm-hmm. For us, we're born in original sin. We don't exactly have an excuse, but we don't have the same vision of God that they did when they made that choice.
Yes.
So we have the possibility of redemption, but their choice was irrevocable, the same way ours is after death.
Right. Question number two from the index of the Catechism. It talks about his activity permitted by divine providence. The power of the devil is limited. What about the power of the devil in our lives?
That's such an important point, because I think one of the things that had confused me about Christian belief during the period when I was not a believer was that I had this mistaken notion that that Christianity taught that there are actually two gods, a form of dualism, a good God and an evil God, the evil God we call Satan, that the two were in a battle in history, and that the outcome of the battle wasn't quite sure.
And which is a common belief amongst other religions in the world.
There are some that have been, and I think on a popular level, some people kind of have that notion that the devil and God are pretty much on an even playing field. But it's so important to realize that the devil is a creature of God, and there is an infinite qualitative difference between the Creator and any creature that God has made. So the devil seems so strong to us because, as pure spirit, he doesn't have some of the limitations we do of a physical body. And the church has taught that the angels were created superior to us in intelligence and in some of their powers. He still has those. He hasn't lost all of that just because he turned against God. Now he uses it for evil. But the important thing to remember is that he is not another God. He is a creature of God. And though he has rebelled against God, and though compared to us he seems to have a great deal more power, nevertheless, Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil, the scripture says, and he's lost.
So maybe the story in the opening of Job is a very good description of the limitation that God allows the devil to do certain things, but to within limits.
That's right. And the reason the Catechism says it's a mystery to us precisely why God does allow it. He allows our free choice, and a lot of the evil in the world is simply because of our free choices, because he wants sons and daughters instead of robots. He has to allow us the free will he gave us. With the devil, it's hard to say, since his decision was already irrevocable, why he's not just bound. But the Catechism affirms, and the Church has always affirmed, that nevertheless, in God's providence, there's wisdom in that, and he's able to bring good out of evil.
Is the devil omnipresent?
Oh, I don't think the church has ever said that.
in the sense that, you know, is he here, but he's also in India at this time?
I think what we'd have to say is that he doesn't have the limits of a physical body, but beyond that, there's so much we don't know.
Right.
But he's pure spirit, and whatever the possibilities are for pure spirit, he has. But omnipresent, I think, is something much greater than that, you know,
that
belongs to God.
Okay, well, let me throw question three at you. This topic is on Jesus' exorcisms. What about those stories we encounter in the Gospels?
Well, you know, when I was going through Yale, the kind of classes I would have there, people would sit down and say, now here's a story about Jesus casting out demons, so we know it's a legend, and that would be the assumption.
Yeah.
And of course, by that time, I'd already been in Europe in ministry for a couple of years. I had seen some exorcisms. I had seen some things that would be hard to explain any other way, and I basically thought they've gotten to me a little too late. Mm-hmm. I might have believed them. But whether it's miracles or food multiplying, other things that I saw during that time, I was not ready to assume that a story was legend just because the person reading had never seen such a thing. But if we try to say that deny the reality of the demons in the Gospels, then where do you draw the line? What else would you throw out?
Yeah.
I understand that in history, plenty of times people have attributed to demons things that were actually either psychosomatic illnesses or due to chemical malfunction of the brain. Epilepsy was for a long time attributed to demons, that kind of thing. So I understand that there has been plenty of mistakes made by people about that. But if we take this story seriously at all, I don't know how you take a psychosis and you throw it into a herd of swine.
Yeah. That's exactly right. And you know, I don't have time to go through this on the program, but as a young pastor, just like you encountered some things there in Europe. As a young pastor, I got myself in trouble one time with a woman in my church that was encountering strange things in her life. And when I was alone as a pastor praying for this very elderly woman, I found myself in the company of someone who was speaking with a voice a whole lot different than this older woman, and it was scary. I didn't want to ever do that alone again. And so it hit me very quickly. It confirmed the reality of this. But and the sad thing is the devil, on the one hand, we said earlier, would like us not to believe in him at all. Or on the other hand, imitate God so often that we write off the supernatural because it gets mixed up with the things that aren't supernatural. Mm-hmm. So in the process, we throw out the baby with the bathwater. Question 4. This deals with the temptation of Jesus and the temptation of man by the devil. How does the devil work in our lives to tempt us?
Well, the Catechism notes that most often he works directly on us spiritually and sometimes physically in an indirect way. So that, for instance, if he influences someone to hurt you physically, then indirectly he has caused that physical harm. But usually it's spiritual harm. And I would say the temptation is probably the primary way that he does that. We look at the story of the fall in the garden, and there the serpent tempts, and the Catechism confirms this, not only by encouraging our foreparents to disobey God, but first by encouraging them to lose their trust in God, to lose their faith, to doubt the goodness of God. And I think probably in my own life, that's where I've seen the devil work the most, is he will come in the most sly ways, and either through the words of other people, things I read, circumstances he may have influenced, thoughts that perhaps are somehow influenced by him, will want me to doubt the goodness of God. Because once you doubt the goodness of God, once you lose the trust, the faith in God, then disobedience becomes a real possibility.
Well, that particular temptation of Eve was not a one-time thing. It happens in our lives all the time when he holds up something that would distract us from God. And that you mentioned the Flip Wilson thing. He doesn't make us sin.
That's right.
It's when we give in ourselves. Let me throw another question in, a little aside from this. Where does God's will fit in here? I read recently in a 100-year-old Catholic text, it was a powerful text, that reminds us that nothing happens apart from the will of God. But what about our sin and temptation and the work of devil? Is it all the will of God in our life?
Well, I think we have to understand the notion of a permissive will rather than God's active will, that he allows certain things. There actually is a redemptive side to suffering. Given that the world is broken because of our sin, once that's given, then there are certain things that that the suffering God can bring good out of, that he can use it to redeem us. It can become our ally in the process of becoming sanctified, of becoming saints.
It gets back to that statement about his activity is permitted by divine providence. It's only permitted. There's a level. He's contained. But God knows what, we might say, well, why don't you get rid of the devil? Well, he will in his timing. But he knows what's best for his creation as he helps us grow as a father to children in our holiness.
Well, I had a Bible teacher friend, a wise old man who wrote a book once. His name was Bob Mumford, called The Purpose of Temptation. And that book meant so much to me in my young Christian life because he talked about how the temptation really does have a useful purpose in your life, and that if you resist it, it strengthens you every time. It clarifies where you stand. When you're presented with a choice, That's a good thing in itself.
Yes.
If you can make the right choice. And of course it can lead us down the other way too. But temptation itself is not a bad thing. It's how we respond to temptation. Jesus was tempted.
Yeah, it's how we strengthen ourselves by resisting the little venial sins. Strengthens us to deal with the big ones so that we can stand up against them. I'll give you another question here, the last one in this summary. Through sin, he has a certain control over man. What control, really? What power does the devil have over us in our lives?
Well, the church teaches that the original sin into which we're born has weakened our nature. It's led to what we might call an infirmity in our will. And I would say, and I think the church would say as well, that actual sin adds to that. That every time we sin, in a sense, we are giving a little more power to the devil. We're making ourselves more vulnerable to his attack. And on the contrary, every time we resist him, every yes we say to God and no we say to the devil, it becomes a little bit easier to do that the next time. Our will becomes strengthened and perfected that way. So I think it is true to say that he doesn't have total control of us, But he does have a certain leverage, you might say, a certain weight in our lives, a certain pressure on our wills that increases the more we sin, the more that pressure, the more we're susceptible to that pressure.
And we can make ourselves more and more susceptible, or allow ourselves to be, or be blind to. You were talking about even the stuff you messed around with there as a teenager, to the point where we find ourselves with connections that can hurt our lives, that we have to be very sensitive to. It reminds me of that old story about the frog in the pot, right? You throw a frog in a boiling hot water, what's he going to do? He's going to jump out of there. But you put it in when it's cold and you increase it. We all heard that story. Well, that's the way the devil works in our culture, has worked in our lives. The little one, the little steps. I mean, if you'd have thrown Roe versus Wade on the culture of the 1940s, it would never have been accepted. 1930s. But slowly, 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 we get to a point where today we accept things that we never would have dreamed accepting 50, 60, 80 years ago, and the devil laughs. Maybe to tie this together with all the also the topic we were thinking of discussing on the Jubilee and the end of this millennia, when I came into the church, I heard a story, a powerful story about Pope Leo XIII had a dream about 100 years ago. And out of that dream, he wrote a prayer called the St. Michael Prayer. Had you ever heard of those before you became a Catholic?
Oh, I never had, though I did pretty soon after.
That's right. Well, tell me about those. Tell the audience about those, if you can, that story.
I don't know all the details. I can't recall the details. But I think the basic story is that, true story, is that the Holy Father was at the altar.
Yes.
And that he went into what some thought was a coma, I suppose you'd call it a trance, but anyway, had a vision then, or perhaps auditory,
yeah.
Hearing the devil talking to God.
He was actually having an encounter with Jesus in his vision.
Yes, God the Son, and demanding or insinuating that if he had the power he wanted to do what he wanted to do, that he could take away the church or he could destroy the church.
I think he said, give me 100 years.
And in any case, that's according to the story, that's what happened. And that the Lord said, I'll give you that century. And in much the same way, it sounds like the story of Job.
Yes.
Same kind of thing, where the devil says, I can destroy this servant of yours if you just give me power. But he drew the line. The Lord drew the line. Mm. And look at the last century we've had.
Yeah. And when the Pope awoke from that, which many people thought, again, he was dying, he shared this vision and wrote this prayer, the St. Michael Prayer, which is such a powerful prayer. Mm. And I wonder if you could say the prayer for it. It's going to be on the screen. Maybe say the prayer, because some of our audience maybe never heard this very powerful prayer that used to be said after every Mass in every parish in America.
Mm. Now, there's some variations in the
yes.
wording, but as I learned it, it's St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle, be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world for the ruin of souls.
A very powerful prayer.
Yes.
And I think just the fact that that prayer was a regular part of the life of every single Catholic proclaims the fact that the Church takes the spiritual battle very seriously. And we should too, especially during these difficult times. Again, you said, look at the last 100 years.
Well, it has certainly become part of my spiritual life, my family's spiritual life. We say this prayer together as a family every morning. I pray it individually. We pray it in our parish after Mass in the morning. So at least 3 times a day, it's a prayer on my lips.
And what we should encourage our audience to do, too, for
oh,
their lives.
For sure.
Very much
sure.
So. Well, thanks, Paul. Let's open the doors so that our audience can cast a few questions at you.
All right.
And let's take a moment now, first of all, to a caller this evening. Hello, what's your name and what's your question for us?
Hello?
Hello.
Hi. My name is Mike, and I'm a teacher in the Philadelphia Archdiocese. I teach at a Catholic high school, theology.
Hello, Mike.
And I have a question relating to teaching to the Satan, the reality of Satan to the youth. I wondered if your guest could give me some tips on that, since he first got involved with the understanding of Satan, I think he said, when he was in high school.
Yes. Oh, great question.
I'd say the most important thing to do is to make sure that, number one, that your students understand what we said a while ago, that God is God and Satan is just a creature, so that they don't begin to have an unhealthy fear or anxiety about the devil. And second, that you, as you talk about the enemy, that you don't feed any kind of unhealthy anxiety or preoccupation. Especially for young people, it's very easy to get caught up in that kind of thing. It can be sensational. I'll probably be accused of being sensational tonight for talking about it. But I think the most important thing is to keep in mind you want to keep them close to what the Scripture and the rest of the church's tradition has to say about it. I'd use the catechism. I wouldn't spend much time on speculation. If they begin to bring up all kinds of stories that they might have heard second or third hand, I wouldn't spend much time with that, because that kind of thing can get carried away with people attributing everything to the devil. But so, in short, I'd say focus on what the church has actually taught about it, and also focus on the positive, on the power that God has given to his church through the Holy Spirit to overcome the devil in our lives. Teach them the St. Michael's Prayer. Teach them the Guardian Angel Prayer. Teach them that we can make a difference in contributing to the final overthrow of the enemy.
Clarify a bit on the issue of fear. Fearing God, but you said not fear the devil. But yet, is there a sense in which there's to a point?
Well, there's always healthy fear. I mean, there's a healthy fear of God as well. Yeah. It's the same kind of healthy fear you have of a chainsaw when you use it. Mm-hmm. You know that if you mishandle it, if you get in the way of it in certain ways, that it's going to cause you trouble. And I'd say the same way with the enemy. For instance, you don't get involved with occult things, and that would be another thing I should mention here, that young people often are tempted to get involved with Ouija boards, that kind of thing, and they need a warning about that kind of thing. They think it's a game, usually. Let them know that there's a healthy kind of fear, that you don't...
We don't want anxiety.
But we don't want preoccupation. We don't want, especially, some sense that somehow the devil's bigger or stronger than God is. My son has this great song that he sings that he picked up from a Christian videotape. That's God is bigger than the boogeyman. And I think that's a good thing that we need to tell him, that God is bigger than the devil.
That's right. And parents, never forget the spiritual battle for our children. So in our prayers, in the blessing of our children, in the witness of our lives, and mea culpa. Mea culpa. I'm not pointing fingers at anyone else except myself and my own need. To remember, to never take our children and their spiritual lives for granted.
Oh, that's for sure. And watch what they read. Watch what they watch on television. There's so much television and popular music, radio today that surely has influence from the enemy, the kinds of things being fed them.
We've got to be careful that we don't write off all technology as evil.
Right.
It's the use of technology.
Well, here we are sitting on a television.
That's right, exactly.
There's certainly good uses. But I think one of the things you have to do by the time your child is 18 and ready to move away is that you have to have taught them discernment. That they're going to be bombarded with those kinds of things throughout life. You've got to learn something about how to discern.
Let's go to this email. It goes right along with the same issue. How does one differentiate between the influences of the devil and our own personal sinfulness when it comes to temptations we experience on a daily basis?
That's an excellent question. I'd say we should always assume that the devil has his influence, and we should always assume that our will is free, sometimes to less extent than others, especially if we've built chains by habits. But I don't think we need to worry from day to day about how much of this is me and how much is the devil. It's almost a moot point in the sense that when we sin, we cooperate with the devil. Just as when we don't sin, when we become holy, we cooperate with God. So I hope I'm not avoiding the question. What I'm trying to say is that I don't think we want to be preoccupied with trying to figure out how much is the devil and how much is us.
Yeah, the focus is to be perfect as our Heavenly Father is perfect. That's the model we're to look at. Mm-hmm. And regardless of what it is that's causing us to fail, that's the direction we're to grow in. We're to look in that. And the issue of mea culpa, our need for recognizing our own sinfulness, our own weakness, regardless of where that temptation is coming from, and then to turn our eyes to Jesus. Let's go to another, let's go to a email. Let's check this email. Because I think it fits in. Marcus, you asked a question at the beginning of the program related to the devil being omnipresent. However, isn't there more than one devil, more than Satan himself? Aren't there many evil spirits roaming about the world seeking the ruin of souls? Thank you.
That's an excellent point. What to some of us at times may seem like an omnipresence of the devil, is simply the multiplicity of his allies. There is an entire angelic race, and a good portion of that race, the tradition tells us, fell and became demons. So the ancient Christians used to speak about how the devil giving commands, orders to some of his under henchmen, you might say, and even how the devil wouldn't know what was going to happen. But sometimes if he seemed to be able, through someone, to prophesy something happening, it was because he had demons in other parts of the world reporting back to him. And they weren't confined by space because they didn't have physical bodies. So I think that's an excellent point, that there's only one devil in the sense of Satan, the adversary. But he has an entire host of followers, helpers, allies.
Would you still recommend Screwtape Letters?
Oh, always. Yes.
Great.
It's a powerful book.
Because you read that and you realize, yeah, that happens to me all the time.
Yes.
You know, the way he describes that, those two little devils working on how they're going to tempt
That's
us.
Right.
You know, C.S. Lewis had great insight in that book. Let's take another caller. Hello, what's your name and what's your question for us tonight?
Hi, I'm Jeff Morris.
Hello, Jeff.
And my question had to do with the discernment of spirits, which you had just covered. I'm struggling with a spiritual battle myself since my conversion about 8 months ago. Mm. And within spiritual direction, I've encountered the Holy Spirit coming upon me. And I've also encountered spiritual beings through the hands-on healing type of practices. And so during these experiences, you know, I'm not sure if, you know, is it holy or is it not, and do you keep with it or not?
Okay. Thank you, Jeff. Yeah, this the issue of discernment, which is a scriptural command to us to discern the spirits. How does one discern good or bad?
Well, my own experience has been multiple ways, and I don't know that there's any one particular way that's best, but it seems to me you need to develop your life of prayer. The closer we become to God in prayer, I think the more sensitive we become to whatever is not God. I think we have to read the Scripture, to read daily what we can about what God's will for our life is. It sounds like Jeff, I think, has a spiritual director. I'd say that's an excellent thing. So many things that we can't see ourselves very well, if we have a good spiritual director, that person can help us.
Yeah. And to never be alone. I mean, in the sense that...
That's a good point, yes.
We aren't just these lonely coals, as that old, you know, image, outside of the fire. The fellowship, the church. It's not just Jesus and me. It's us. And so the spiritual growth of someone is to develop spiritual brothers and sisters that we can share, we can ask those questions that Jeff struggles with, so that he has spiritual warriors standing side by side. C.S. talks about that, remember, the book Four Loves, mm-hmm. about friendship is when you stand side by side and you focus on one common goal or issue. In the spiritual battle, we need spiritual brothers and sisters standing all around us. That's the church. Let's go to another email message that fits in with the topic. How can someone tell when they are in the company of someone that may be evil? Is it possible for someone to be evil even when they seem to be a prayerful and spiritual person?
Oh, well, I'm a little reluctant to describe a person as evil, just out and out evil. The church makes it really clear that all people are created with a basic goodness, that we're broken, though we have original sin. So no one's perfectly evil. If evil is the deprivation of good, St. Augustine says, then you can't have anything perfectly evil, because there'd be nothing left there. There's always something good there that God wants to redeem, as far as a human being. Now, as far as the matter of being around someone who perhaps has a controlling influence by an evil spirit, I'd recommend reading the lives of the saints that have had to deal with that kind of thing. And can't go into all the details now, but it's useful, I think, sometimes to look at the lives of the saints and some of the situations they encountered, how they were able to discern. We don't want to go too much on feelings. But I think someone who is deeply influenced by an evil spirit typically recoils from the name of Jesus. Strongly recoils from the name of Jesus, or would recoil from a crucifix, would have a hard time in the presence of the Blessed Sacrament, those kinds of things.
Mm-hmm. And Jesus said, by their fruits you'll know them. You know, when we're around people who are not really of the Lord, in time, their fruits are going to let us know whether they're of God or not. They can't imitate or you know, pretend forever.
Yeah. And there's, you know, there's the evil lurking outside our door for each of us. So I guess what I want to get at is I don't want to classify anybody as perfectly right. good and perfectly evil in this life.
We're all sinners in need of grace.
Sinners. But if we're talking about the influence of evil spirits, then there are certain things like that can help us tell.
Very good. All right, another caller, if we would. Hello, what's your name and what's your question for us?
Hi, my name is Lynette. I'm from Clearwater, Florida.
Hello.
We were talking, or you were talking earlier about how the devil, you know, how we don't, I'm sorry, I'm trying to get my words right here, how we sometimes take the devil for granted, like he's not there, you know, we don't believe in him as much. But isn't there the other end of the scope where you can believe in him too much and we blame on him for every little thing that goes wrong in our lives?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, and I think we made that point a little earlier that preoccupation with the devil is just as dangerous as not believing in the devil at all. And I know folks who, again, like Flip Wilson's character, says the devil made me do it, and behind every bush there's a devil. And some of the circles I moved in, I saw that again and again. But the point is, we need to recognize his reality and let that prompt us to prayer. Let that prompt us to be careful, to think that. We don't want to assume that we're above temptation. We don't want to assume that that there's not someone out there who's in usually very subtle or sly ways out to slip, make a slip.
Yeah. Let's take this email, and Paul, I'm wondering if these are people that know you, Greg Pugh and Heather Camps. It said, Paul, you're doing great.
Greg is our youth director.
Oh, great.
And Heather, the two of them work with our youth group that meets in our home.
Well, great. It says, Heather and I have a question. What are some biblical principles on how to resist the devil?
Oh, that's a great question. Resist the devil. Let's take a look at what Jesus did in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. He was tempted by the devil then. He quoted the scripture and didn't just mouth it, but of course he quoted it with faith. He knew that the word of God was powerful, was a two-edged sword, as the scripture says, able to pierce through and to discern. So I think that's one of the things we need to do. We need to know the word of God. We need to hide it away in our hearts, to use one expression.
Which is an encouragement to Catholics to read the Bible,
yes,
to
it
know
is.
It, to yes, memorize it scriptures, to make it a part of every day of our lives so that we're prepared in the battle.
That's right. Number one. Number two is prayer. And this is one thing I've come to appreciate as a Catholic, is not just praying to God, which of course is most important, but to ask the angels for their help, to ask our guardian angel for his help, to ask St. Michael for his help. I didn't even know those prayers when before I became a Catholic. And prayer is the most powerful weapon we have.
Let me throw in, what about the rosary in this battle?
Oh, of course. Oh, my goodness. Well, when you start thinking about, especially many of the things that the Blessed Mother's had to say in the yes. last century and a half,
yes.
and the role the Lord seems to have given her in crushing, and her seed crushing the serpent, then certainly I think she has a role, and we're able to take part in that role when we ask her to pray for us.
She's reiterated over and over the power of the rosary, specifically in this battle, particularly Fatima.
Yes.
And so we must never take that beautiful prayer for granted. Well, great. Let's turn to another caller, if we would. Hello, what's your name and what's your question for us tonight?
Yes, hello. My name is Mark Hinton,
yes,
and I'm from Brooklyn, New York. I would like to ask your guest a question. Can Christians be open to possession, or can they be open to oppression? What is the difference between oppression and possession?
Thank you.
Thank you. Is Mark right? That's a question that Pentecostal circles have argued for a number of years. So it's an issue that has certainly exercised me. Part of it's a matter of terminology, I think. The influence of the devil has many degrees. I think you find some cases like the ones that Jesus encountered, where he seems to be in control of a person. The man who lived in the graveyard, ran around naked and cutting himself, and people couldn't even get near him. That seems to be a clear case of out-and-out possession, where the man, for one reason or another, was almost totally, I won't say totally, but almost totally under the control of the enemy. But then the influences can be of other kinds. I think certainly if a Christian disobeys the will of God and involves himself or herself in serious sin, that they open the door to all kinds of things. Certainly involvement in certain occult practices, I think, can open the door. The Catechism teaches real clearly about not being involved in divination practices and that kind of thing. I think we there are channels there of spiritual connection, you might say.
Especially absence from the sacraments.
That as well, of course. I mean, every sin in a sense weakens, like I said before, weakens our will, mm-hmm. makes us more vulnerable to Him. But in particular, I don't want to say necessarily that a Christian believer could be totally possessed. I don't know the answer to that question, but I don't want to find out either. I want us, you know, myself and all of us to do everything we can to resist the devil. And the Scripture says if we resist him, he'll flee.
That's right. And since there is no unforgivable sin except that final rejection mm-hmm. of God, that everyone can, through the power of God, all things are possible to God, be freed from whatever influence there is in their life, so we can be free to follow Jesus. As we close this time, I need to ask this question, Paul. In your own spiritual journey, how is, in your own journey of being received in the Catholic Church and understanding the truths of the Catholic Church, helped you grow in your own personal relationship with Christ?
Oh, my. Can we have another couple hours?
We've got about a minute or two.
I see. You know, the Church talks again and again, Vatican II talks again and again, the Catechism, about the fullness of grace and of truth in the Catholic Church. And I have such a deep appreciation for all that I learned in the Protestant churches I've been in, and I've been a part of several, and will always be grateful for so much that I learned, so many of the basics. What has changed my life about being Catholic has been the fullness that I've found there. And it's not just a theoretical fullness. I mean, I could give 1,000 examples. One is the Eucharist. Another would be the communion of saints and the help of the saints. Another would be discovering my spiritual mother, Mary. I mean, I could go on and on, but there's so much that I just didn't know and couldn't experience before. The other sacraments, confirmation mm-hmm. and penance, and all those things are a part of Catholic fullness that I can't imagine life without mm-hmm. now.
It almost felt like before I was walking in a puddle, and there was certainly mm-hmm. water there, but I was walking in a puddle. And for me, walking into the Catholic faith was like, you know, wow, yes. I'm over my head. You know, there's so much here. And there's so much more for us to continue to learn for the rest of our lives as we walk and follow Christ.
Grace
Paul,
upon grace.
Great to have you on the show.
Marcus,
what
good
a joy.
To see you. God bless you.
Thank you for taking this difficult topic, one you didn't know you were going to encounter when you got on an airplane.
Well, I'll say pray for me, okay? Pray for me. Thanks.
And we'll ask our audience to continue to pray for us as we continue to pray for them. Now stay with us. We'll be back in a moment for a few closing thoughts for the journey home. Welcome back to The Journey Home. We've had a very informative evening with Dr. Paul Thigpen, good friend, good faithful brother, talking about a difficult subject. That is one, though, that we must be very well aware of in our lives as we follow Christ. I'd like to close with a couple thoughts from Scripture that remind us about this spiritual battle that we are to take very seriously. I'd like to begin by reading a portion of the end of Ephesians chapter 6. It says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we are not contending against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Saint Paul reminds us, encourages us to remember that this battle is just not the battle that we see, that is a difficult battle, but behind the battle we see is the spiritual battle, and therefore it should drive us to our knees, recognizing that we need Jesus, as we need each other. We need his body, the church. I was reminded that Padre Pio, when asked how to battle the devil, was reminded in the power of the name of Jesus. The most powerful prayer we have is to pray the name of Jesus. Helps us in discernment, helps us in strength, giving us the grace we need so that we can fight the battle. I'd like to turn to another portion of Scripture as we end. It essentially comes from our first Pope, St. Peter of Rome, and maybe what might be called his first encyclical, the letter of 1 Peter. Listen to this. He says, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may exalt you, cast all your anxieties on him, for he cares about you. Be sober, be watchful. An important word during these final years of the millennium. Be watchful. For your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experience of suffering is required of your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, establish, and strengthen you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. We're in this together, and it's a battle. We've got to remember to lift each other up in prayer, to encourage each other to read Scripture, to read the teachings of the church, so that we're equipped with that great armor of God, that we would ask God's Spirit to fill our lives, to give us what we need, the words we need, to not be caught up in anxiety because of the devil and his hordes, but recognizing that with the great, powerful protection of St. Michael the Archangel and our guardian angels, and side by side as brothers and sisters, we can fight the victorious fight as brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for joining me on the journey home. With his grace, we'll be together again next week. God bless you.